Welcome to the American Humanist Association's Critical Mind series. My name is Emily Newman, and I'm the AHA's Senior Education Coordinator. Today, I'm happy to share Religion and Mental Health, Helpful or Harmful, with Suandria Hall. She is a secular, client-centered mental health counselor and life coach. She focuses on life transitions and religious trauma. She spent over 20 years in the healthcare arena, including public health and clinical research. She now counsels and coaches individuals and groups and speaks to further provide insight to the impact of harmful religious experiences. So thank you so much for joining us, and I will hand it off to you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Emily, for the introduction. Thank you so much to the organization for this opportunity. It's truly a gift. And I want to send Kristen Wintermute a shout out. She has been so helpful in helping put this together. So thank you, Kristen. And I also wanted to thank and make sure I mention Sikibu Hutchinson. She is a dear colleague of mine that, you know, those people that speak about you in rooms when you're across the country, not even thinking about it. It's her. And I just wanted to send a shout out because she connected me and Kristen. So thank you, Sikibu. And I'll just jump right in. You know, when I was 13, 14 years old, I remember walking into the kitchen where my mom was, and I was good for a question. And this question was, how do I know I'm not going to hell? And my mom, busy with cooking, just kind of looked at me and said, girl, stop it. You're going to heaven. I was like, but mom, how do I know? And she said, because you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And I said, did I? Wouldn't I do that? Suandria, cut it out. You did. Mom, I really don't think I did. And she said, well, when you're 12 years old, there's something called the age of accountability. And where I grew up, the church that I was into, 12, which is when Jesus began his ministry, that's the age that we used to say, it's time for you to accept Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior so that you can be cleansed of your sin and forgiven and make sure that you get your ticket to heaven. And I said, Mom, I've never said that prayer. Suandria, yes, you did. Really, I didn't. Stop it, girl. Okay. And then I went on about my life. You know, it's one of the earliest memories I have where I express some autonomy around my religious experience, my childhood religious experience. And I remember this story. I can still feel it. And it really said a lot to me about the expectations that were on me as a child and as a religious kid. And, you know, I think it's narratives that really tell the story. When I'm working with clients, it is where I start. These rich personal stories provide a wealth of insight for me and for my clients as we kind of piece together how they've arrived where they are, wherever they may be, religious or not, questioning or not, just tell me about your story. And the question I typically start with my clients is, how did you meet Jesus? And I'll start there for myself today. My parents introduced me to Jesus. They were 16 years old when they met Jesus. They are both from a very small town in Piedmont, Alabama. And country folks grew up in the 60s. And, you know, it was a town where they experienced early integration of schools and things like that. So I hear all kinds of stories from my parents about the white water fountains, black water fountains, colored water fountains, about standing in hallways to say, hopefully the doctor will get to us today after he's seen all of the white patients that are sitting comfortably in the lobby. And it's no wonder that when this charismatic husband and wife showed up to their town, Piedmont, Alabama, and pitched a tent revival, that it was very impactful for them. And I'm not sure who knows what a tent revival is, but it's when, similar to a circus, right? A pastor and his ministry of music and staff will show up in a town, sawdust on the floors, pitch a tent, a makeshift pulpit, and they would have church. these would be revivals out in the sticks, and you would hear amazing gospel music playing, and it would just call you in. And this is what happened with my parents at 16. They came in, they got born again, and they were down for the cause. This changed the trajectory of their lives, which also changed the trajectory of my life, or impacted my life. But church for me was good. The pastor and his wife were Black, and they were charismatic, beautiful to look at, and they spoke with authority and power and fearlessness. And that's a big deal when you're from a Southern town, again, growing up in the throes of racism, to see someone seemingly win at life and to be so confident about it. They latched on pretty quickly. And not only were they preaching the word, they were active in their communities. I remember even from a young age, people would live with us while they were in transition. My parents were kind of on call when people in the church had issues at home or issues with their children. They were very focused on making sure that people were employed, that people had food and shelter and help with drug and alcohol issues, domestic issues, everything. This was a group of people that were all about the work of the ministry and the work of the community. And I always say, you know, my experience with religion wasn't as painful as some of my clients. And I always like to share my personal story because I think it's important to know that we can walk away from a belief system, even if it wasn't necessarily as harmful as someone may think it should be to leave, but any reason is a good reason to change your mind about how you live your life because you want to do something more authentic to you. And that's what happened to me. I was born into fundamentalism, and fundamentalism basically means it is the literal interpretation of the Bible, right? It's if God said it, I believe it, that settles it. That was a very popular term for my church. And if God said it meant God, the Bible, God speaking through religious leaders, God inspired by the Holy Spirit, by anyone really, we just had to believe it. You know, it was kind of a blind faith. We were given the instructions on how to be a man, how to be a woman, how to be married, heaven and hell, and how you get to each of those or avoid one, what we do with our finances, what we do, sex and sexuality, where we work. Everything was impacted by the word of God. Again, this was a literal interpretation. And it wasn't until I was about 20 years old, I was 20 years old, and I finally left my home church, moved to big city, Atlanta, Georgia, and I met a larger congregation. This pastor and his wife were college educated. My parents were not. And they just had a different spin. I always call it a new expression of Christianity. And honestly, I was primed. I was primed to plug right in to a religious organization, but this was different. They had money, they drove nice cars, and they had big, beautiful homes. And the message was, yes, love, yes, Jesus is the answer, but it was also, you can do well in your life. You don't have to be sad, you don't have to be sick, you don't have to be broke. It was a different spin than the religious experience that I had growing up. We were very community-based and helping people just stand on their 2 feet. But this church was, you know, you're going to win. You're going to be at the front of the line, and whatever you want in this life, you can have it. I loved it. I thought my life is going to never be the same. I have a direct, you know, ear with God, and I have power in my life. And I dug in. I was in the choir. I worked in youth ministry, women's ministry. And I remember one day we were out doing evangelism. And if you don't know what that means, that is the call of Christians to evangelize the world. preach Jesus, bring people into the fold, get people saved, right? Avoiding hell, get people saved. We were on this Saturday morning door-to-door evangelism journey, and we were in an inner city neighborhood, pretty sure mostly Black. Every resident that I encountered was Black. And we're knocking on the doors to say, hey, I got some good news for you. I want to tell you about Jesus. And after doing that about three or four times, I just felt icky inside. You know, we're in a Black community in the South. And I thought, which of these people that I'm knocking on their doors on Saturday morning to disturb them don't already know about Jesus? Where I'm from, Black people know about Jesus. I thought it would be a better use of our time and interruption of these people's day to maybe say, what do you need? Right? Don't need you to get saved, but we're supposed to do the work of the church. What do you need? Is it food? Is it work? Is it a babysitter? Is it a grocery store run? Gas in the car? Just something tangible to show the love of Christ. But that's not what we were doing. We were kind of showing up with this, we have the answer. Our way of being a Christian, our way of being a believer is the right way. And let me lead you to it. And by the way, once you join us, we're going to also need 10% of your earnings. And we're going to also need you to sow seed, give more money on top of that, because this is how you're blessed. It just started to feel really, really icky inside. And for the first time in my life, I said, just making sure everyone can see me. I saw a question come through, Emily, that said it's a black screen. Just wanted to point that out. Okay. It was the first time in my life I started to say, why do I believe this? Why do I believe it? What do I believe? Do I have to believe it? Is there another way to be good? And I started a journey of curiosity. Up until that point, anything I read about religion was confirmation to the beliefs I already held. At this moment in my life, I started to read everything that was different, anything that was of interest to me, anything that maybe I hadn't read before. It was the first time I read the Bible cover to cover. Here I am living a life committed to a belief system, and I haven't even read the book, right? And I dug in. I dug into history. I dug into different religious beliefs. I dug into what it means to be Black in America and how Christianity impacted enslaved people and how that's still playing out today. And slowly, 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 I started to change. And I remember coming to a point, I was sitting at work, and this was the last prayer I prayed. And it was, God, if you are real, you're going to have to prove it. You're going to have to show me. But what I'm not going to do is continue down this path. I'm not going to pledge my allegiance and commitment to a belief system that I don't believe is required. I don't believe everyone has to do it. I don't believe people are going to hell. The God that I started to know was about love. And even that started to chip away to say, the person that I am is about love. And I don't have to have a deity to tell me how to do that. I just started to trust myself. Now, what I didn't expect to feel was this pull, right? There's a story. I don't know how true this is, but I remember this kind of story that people tell about elephant training, where you take a baby elephant and you chain one of his legs to the ground and spike in the ground so the elephant can't move. So years and years of this training where the elephant can't move, even if he tries, right? There's always a halt. The elephant grows up and the trainer can put that elephant in the same place, whether the spike and chain is around his leg or not, he won't move, right? And that's how I started to feel. Like, I knew I was free. I was thinking different. I was feeling different emotionally. I gave myself the freedom to question. But every time I made a step that was outside of what I had been taught, I felt the pull. If I wanted to stop tithing, and I did, but I felt the pull. Oh no, my life's going to fall apart. I'm not going to be blessed. Anything I became curious about, to even say I didn't believe in God, I felt the pull. And this is where we talk about trauma and religious trauma specifically. I'm going to start with a few definitions, and I pulled these from some of the experts in the field around trauma. We are traumatized when, bear with me here, we are traumatized when our central nervous system, the way we move, our bodily sensations, our thinking, our speech, our memory is overwhelmed and it's altered the way that we process or recall memories. We're traumatized when we experience incompleted or unresolved responses. We kind of get stuck. We are traumatized when we are overstimulated repeatedly, cumulatively, usually over a period of time and within a specific context. And in this context, we're talking about religion. We are traumatized when an extremely stressful event happens too much, too fast, too soon, and we're unable to resume safety. Now, in plainer terms, I'll define religious trauma as when your ability to respond or create or experience safety is interrupted, you're unable to release or complete the process, the nervous system showing up for you to think, to move, to fight, to flight, to freeze, voluntarily is interrupted and something else takes over. And that something else is your nervous system saying, hey, if you can't do it, we'll do it for you. And here's a really plain way to say it. Your brain and your body says, hey, it's time to take care of yourself. Here's the blood flow. Here are the chemicals. Here's the energy to do it. But you don't, because your religious teaching has said, obey, stay silent, trust God, trust the word, trust the leaders, anything but yourself, right? There are scriptures that say, lean not to your own understanding, acknowledge God in all of your ways. There's so many scriptures that lead you away from trusting yourself to give it to someone or something else. Now, how does that look? How does that play out in a person's life? Give you a couple examples from my clients. I want to meet other people outside of my community that have different beliefs. That trauma, that pause, that religious teaching shows up and says, nope, they're dangerous, they're sinful. They'll lead you astray. You must obey. You need to maintain the relationships here. You must have community acceptance here. Keep away from people and cultures that are unlike you, right? They'll interrupt your belief. They'll turn you. They'll lead you to hell. And these perpetuate issues like racism, social injustice in general, inequality. We can't be around people that aren't like us, right? We're the elite, we're God's chosen. Everyone else is not allowed. Another example, I want another path to life and to love and to purpose. I want to explore some different interests outside of this book, outside of the way that it's been given to me. Trauma shows up, nope, stay in God's will. Doubt your ability to make decisions because you have to go to God, you have to go to leaders, you have to hear from the Holy Spirit. Wait for someone or something else to guide you, right? Limit your education and opportunities. If you do go, make sure you filter it through the lens of religion, right? Another one, I'm curious about sex and sexuality. I want to have ownership of my body. The religious teaching shows up. Nope, your body is not your own. It belongs to God. And for women, it belongs to your dad and then your husband. It's never truly yours. Submit, obey. Marriage is only for man and woman. And what does that create? struggles with intimacy, sexuality, even a simple, what seems as a simple touch. I have clients that struggle with routine health screenings because to be naked in front of someone just feels sinful. Even though you're there to get help, to be touched, to be examined feels wrong, right? Even though you're there for a good reason, the body remembers it. So is American religion's fundamentalism helpful or harmful? I honestly leave that up for people to decide for themselves. You know, I always say I didn't leave, you know, one proselytizing experiment or experience for another. I don't need you to be on my team. I need you to be on your team, to trust yourself, believe in yourself, honor yourself, right? So is it helpful or harmful? Let's think about it. Let's look at prayer, right? And Pew Research gives really great data on people that believe in God and how this relationship with God or this belief system plays out in their lives. So if we look at prayer, can it be helpful? Sure. It's similar to meditation and yoga, deep breathing. So how can it be harmful? If we become stagnant, you're unable to make choices or take action after the prayer. When the practice isn't aimed toward freedom and autonomy and awareness and healing, instead the prayer that I experience and many of my clients have, the prayer is to be obedient. You're wanting something outside of the faith. This prayer brings you back into silence, into submission. I think about racism and how the church community, especially for my parents, it meant safety. It meant I get to be around a group of people where I feel seen and understood and cared for. But if that church community is saying no one else belongs here, and we're seeing that in America right now, where churches are saying very specific things and saying this is God's leading that minorities don't get the same care, that police brutality doesn't need to be addressed, right? There's so much happening right now and churches are saying it, right? They're holding up this standard that says we are God's people and what we say goes. Harmful. I think about community in general and, you know, where else can you get the opportunity to go to the same place? For me, it was Sunday, Wednesday, sometimes Friday, sometimes Saturday mornings. You could go to the same place with a group of people that believed like you believed, that you can have friends there and family there, and your children get to grow up with kids that believe the same and think the same. It feels like safety. But again, you are isolated. The truth is only what is deemed truth for that community. It keeps you away from the world. It keeps you away from experiencing other cultures, other beliefs, the opportunity to love and to know someone unlike you. Harmful. And although I'm not religious, that's where I've landed. I'm not religious, but I'm not anti-religion. I'm anti-harm. If it had not been for my personal experience watching my family, my parents, and I'm a preacher's kid, watching the love and the help and the support that my mom and my dad gave to our community, maybe I would be completely anti-religion, but I've seen the goodness of it, but I've also seen the harm, right? My leaving religion was cognitive, right? I learned something different. I didn't need it anymore. I just don't believe it. But I understand how people hold on to it. And, you know, I'm able to step back and see value and purpose of religion in people's lives and in communities. But I can also acknowledge the harm and the danger that has occurred and continues to occur as a result of fundamentalism and the like. You know, the truth is, each of us, we are a lot of things. We have good days, we have bad days. We can do really helpful things and we can do some things that are harmful and painful to others. This exists in each of us, in our families, in our cultures, in our country, and even in religious expression. But we also have the freedom to reflect, to be curious, to critique and to learn, to change as a result of something we learned, and to grow if we choose it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Suandria. I was just about to remind folks that they can type in questions to the Q&A feature on Zoom or in the comments on Facebook Live, and we'll get to as many as possible. And we also will save those that we don't get to and try to find a way to address them. While giving people a moment to think about some of the things, I know in the chat, we did get someone asking, how do you label yourself?
I'm sorry, say that last part again, Emily.
How do you label yourself now, like in terms of the religious secular umbrella?
That's a tough one. I'm not a believer, if that's a label. I'm not anti-religion, I'm anti-harm. I'm secular and human. If the label that folks may be looking for, the question is asking if I'm agnostic or atheist, I lean toward atheism. If I hold out for any bit of agnosticism, it is because I would love there to be an energy or force that loves everyone and is available for everyone. Not that everyone gets good all the time. I don't believe that. Life is happening. It's real. But honestly, labels are tricky for me. Again, it's probably part of my experience in the religious world where you had to have a label. You had to say Jesus is Lord. You weren't invited. And because I don't look for labels on other people, I don't have any that I wear a t-shirt for. I just show up as a human being.
And I wanted to, before I jump into all of the questions coming in, and again, thank you all for submitting. I did want to also highlight, so your practice is exclusively virtual. Mm-hmm. Can you give us a little background? Was it that way before the pandemic? Has the pandemic kind of changed the needs and the way that you communicate with your clients?
It was when I was in grad school, before grad school, it was always my goal to have a virtual practice. And so this was before pandemic. This was my goal. I just wanted to be able to travel the world and still do this work. So the pandemic just kind of pushed things along and opened doors and kind of made it, if not normal, at least acceptable, right? So listen, I just stepped right through that door that was already in my heart to do.
So we have one person wrote that they are a counselor trainee and they're interested in working with survivors of IPV rape and those who suffer from PTSD. So how would you approach treatment for someone who feels guilty or other feelings because of their faith?
I lean into curiosity a lot, right? We would explore the guilt. What exactly are you feeling guilty about? What are the alternatives? What script or thought or activation is present when you feel that guilt? Like, what's going on? And do you have the power to change it? Can you think something else? If you remove the rule or the script that's playing right now that creates the guilt, do you have the freedom to change that? And if you can, what would you change it to? And does the guilt remain? We behave because there's a belief that's at play. So if we can start to look at the belief that's at play, we can change how we feel.
How would you approach disassociation if the individual feels their disassociative episodes are spiritual?
You know, when it becomes, there are levels to trauma, right? And again, my practice is virtual. So there are some levels, if it doesn't feel safe and we start to go into places or I see a level of activation in my client where they're home or at work or in their space during a session, I personally like to have a local therapist that we can connect with, because sometimes that disassociation, again, alone, and I'm not there to help them calm. We do techniques that bring calm to the body because we kind of slowly move into these spaces. And I'm watching as we move into these spaces for activation, for reaction. So where I sit, I'm very mindful of how deep we go and if this client can go there without a resource that's local and available.
And then kind of related, someone asked if you could share your thoughts on the hallucinations and delusions of serious mental illness and visions, like hearing and seeing God talking to you and so on.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's so interesting because, you know, it's always, where do we draw the line, right? When it comes to religion, you can hear from God, you can see dead people, angels can show up, and that's acceptable, right? But when it's outside of religion, then we look at, oh, this is harmful. This is a serious mental issue that we're dealing with, right? I'm always looking for the harm. Is this harmful? Is this behavior harmful? Who are you talking to? What are they saying? What are they asking you to do? Right. Sometimes, again, with trauma, we have developed a way to find safety for ourselves. And again, the body will do it for us if we're not able to. Right. If you're young and you're into this religion and at every turn you're told, no, be quiet, be silent, the body will kick in to say, how do we survive this? And sometimes that survival is creating something that helps us feel safe, a voice, a friend. That no one else sees, right? I invite that friend to the room. What are they saying, right? How do we integrate? Because if you're able to start to speak up for yourself and that friend doesn't have to for you, you lose the need for the friend. You lose the need for the voice. And that's oversimplified, but I just wanted to give kind of a way to kind of unpack that a little bit.
On that, have you welcomed in other individuals of your clients, like brought in like their family or friends to kind of help facilitate discussion among them?
It depends. I leave that up to the client. Sometimes there are couples where one person is no longer believing and they are deconstructing and the spouse still believes, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me, we have to share this world. Not everyone sitting next to me on a bus, in a train, on an airplane, in a restaurant believes the same way I do, right? But how do we do life? What I have those couples do is, let's look at your values, right? And which of these values still align for both of you, right? There are people that dread going home for the holidays because they have to deal with their religious families. Right? Well, let's look at the values. Is there anything that you feel safe and fully engaged, fully autonomous to connect to your family around versus the religious piece? And sometimes that's possible, sometimes it's not. Sometimes the family's religious expression is extremely harmful, right? It's one thing to say, I pray for you that you know, are protected and well, and we have a beautiful year next year. That's one thing. But I pray for you that you get away from these people, that you come back to God, that you don't love this way, that you, you know, get out of this sinful life. We're getting into harm, right? So if people are invited, again, it's usually a couple, or it's just kind of walking through some strategies of how people can re-engage with their families that may still be believers.
And as you say, sometimes it does take a little assistance to have those conversations. I remember a presentation that Dale McGowan gave, and I think it may have been part of his book about from Parenting Beyond Belief of, you know, even if your whole family may use the label of Christianity, a Christian, or say that they follow Christianity, they have different concepts within that. Some are, you know, active churchgoers because mm-hmm. they want to be seen when the people take attendance, and some are there for the music, and others are devoted to every word of the sermon. And some are secret closeted atheists, but just don't feel comfortable coming out to the family. And you kind of don't know where everyone is at, and know that people change throughout their process. And as they learn about different opportunities outside of the church, unless you're able to open up and have those dialogues.
Absolutely. The dialogues are important. And a lot of the times, you know, we're talking about it in the context of religion, but to have the freedom to be who you are regardless, it's huge. Some of this work is about, maybe the client isn't traumatized, but there's a huge adjustment happening as they decided to leave religion. So we're learning about boundaries, what they are, how to communicate them, how to enforce them, when to move that line closer or back to yourself to find safety, speaking up for yourself, exploring sexuality. There's so much happening. It's not always necessarily about the religion. It's who am I? You know, and I go back to not being anti-religion and anti-harm, because again, I think about the history of America, and I think about enslaved people and what got them through. Whether I believe there's a God or not, something about people coming together, a singular value, a singular purpose, the hope and the love and the songs, right? And the celebrations, the community that's created while literal, not perceived danger, but literal danger is happening all around you. I can't rob people of that peace. I don't think that's for me to say, right? This is a very personal. Each of our lives, our value systems are personal. So regardless of what we call it, I think it's a personal journey. And again, I'm always asking, is this helpful? Is this harmful to you and to others? And what's important to you? How do we start to live a life that says, I am being authentic to who I am and who I love, and resisting harm? Staying away from harm, critiquing when we see that harm, calling it out. If we're here to love and to help and to feed people and clothe people, great. But if we're here to say people don't belong, right? They're not worthy of love. They're not worthy of acceptance. We're in the harm range.
So someone wrote, in clinical practice, have you ever found it helpful to push back against a person's religious beliefs?
Absolutely. Again, if it's causing harm, right? I don't know how much harm it causes for a person to say, my expression of religion says that I should volunteer, right? That's not harmful to me. But if there is a harm that says I'm in an abusive relationship, and my religion says I can't divorce, right? I'm also committed to not causing harm to people. So if I know that someone is physically being harmed emotionally, mentally, it is my job to call it out. It is my role to push back. It is my duty to help this person gain some awareness and some courage, right? And the ability to stand up for themselves and choose goodness, to choose love, to choose hope in a way that makes sense for them, right? I'm not anyone's church. I'm not anyone's pastor. I'm not anyone's leader. We do our work. And my goal is when we say goodbye, right? Maybe not first session, not maybe not the first six sessions, but when we end our work and we start to taper off, I hope that people are able to do life on their own and feel confident about that, right? To say no when no is appropriate, to say yes when yes is appropriate. They own their own lives, not the church, right? But each individual.
On a personal note, we had someone asking if you were rejected by your family for moving away from fundamentalist Christianity.
Yeah, by some. I think initially the blow was heavy and people just didn't know how to talk to me, right? It was, the demon has walked into the room. Again, I come from fundamentalism. So we believed in demons and possession and all of that stuff. So I'm the person that, you know, they say has been beguiled by the devil. And it was hurtful and it was isolating and lonely. And honestly, that's a big part of why I got into this work. I felt safe and confident and strong in who I was, who I am, who I was at that time, making these changes and shifting. But who can I talk to about it, right? Because if everyone around you still believes that, you do feel like something's wrong with you. And the trauma, the impact says, well, then be silent, obey, push these thoughts away, right? Bring yourself back into alignment with the word, with the organization, with the group, right? But it took me to expand my community, expand my friendships, expand, again, education-wise, what I was reading, what I was listening to, what I was allowing myself to be a part of, to build a new family and community so that I could withstand those blows. And some of those relationships never bounce back. They're different forever, but it's okay because I am different forever. And if that's what this is, because I'm not going to pretend to be something I'm not, then that's just where we land.
We have a question from Facebook, wanting to know, do you find that more youth are leaving organized religion?
Absolutely. More people are. There's lots of research. Again, check Pew Research. It has been ticking down. There's a trend. Major, major exodus of folks leaving the church, but religion in general, saying, no, this isn't what I signed up for. I thought I was a part of a group of people that love, but I'm seeing, again, harm. This is not what I signed up for. Yeah.
And it seems we have a bunch of therapists and social workers on here. So someone was curious if you found that other therapists are not properly acknowledging religious trauma as a legitimate thing.
Absolutely. I get tons of clients that may already be in therapy and say, can I just talk to you once a month? Can we check in? Because I don't feel like my current therapist either respects or understands religious trauma. They don't acknowledge it. And a lot of times, you know, religion or some form of spirituality is brought into the therapeutic practice. And some clients don't want any parts of that, which is why I've been very clear to say I'm a secular therapist, because I don't bring religion or spirituality into my practice. I have clients that are religious. I have clients that are teetering. I have clients that are spiritual. I meet them where they are. And again, my focus is harm. What is it that you want out of this work together? How do we help you get there? And if I see some things that are holding them back, I'll call it out. But again, there's a big difference in this acknowledgement of religious trauma being a thing, right? We can acknowledge trauma in the things that happen to children. We acknowledge it in racism. We acknowledge in sexism. We acknowledge it abusive relationships, but because over 90% of Americans believe in God or some form, it's hard to find a therapist that will treat it with respect and not point you back to it, right? It's similar to, you know, the dirty uncle that everyone says, oh, that's just Uncle So-and-so. He makes jokes or he may touch you, but we don't do anything. Who points you back to your abuser more than religion and our families? Again, it's toe the line. This is who we are.
So it's interesting you say about, you know, this is who we are, but was also before talking about, you know, not putting total power into the labels that we use. Because somebody did ask, referring to your mention about disliking labels, they're interested in your thoughts on the contemporary demands to label and categorize people according to, you know, particular characteristics. And if you had thoughts on the, I guess, helpfulness and or harm or confusion around labels.
You know, to each his own, I'm going to treat people with dignity and respect. So if there's a label that they prefer, that they have chosen, that is theirs, I'll meet you there. It doesn't hurt me to do that. Again, I treat people with dignity and respect.
And then connected to that, someone was also curious that if a client asks you, what is your religion or your beliefs, especially if they're still considering themselves religious, how do you usually respond to that?
Believe in love. I'm a human first. I care about people, right? I care about children. I want people to have access to food and shelter and education. It's a real simple, we share this planet. You know, I'm going to take care of myself and my family, and I'm going to help others as I can.
So we've talked a lot about Christianity, but we also had a question about your experiences with people from other religions. It's kind of vague, so I guess you can kind of take that as you want. They were just kind of, I guess, curious to know of other experiences.
I don't have other experiences personally. When I left Christianity, I didn't look for another religious belief system. I just, it wasn't for me. But I do have clients that come from different religious organizations. And honestly, a lot of the same threads and themes are present, right? It's the isolation. It's you're not powerful. The deity is, the group is. So those are the things that we're healing from.
How would you respond to those who claim that losing religion will throw our civilization into chaos?
As if we're not in chaos now. I think we need the opportunity to trust in humanity more than we have. Again, we've been given a book or books that say this is what we do. This is how to do it. Can we be curious? Can we explore other alternatives? You know, I don't need God or religion to tell me that I shouldn't steal. It's probably not a good idea to steal from another person. You know, if there are people that we need to take care of, right? Our fellow countrymen, how do we do that? I don't know if God needs to tell me how to do that. Can I see a need and figure out a way to meet the need? I don't think the answers are simple. I think the questions are simple, and we'll still have to kind of wrestle with that, whether there's a deity involved for some or not. This is humanity. Again, treat people with dignity and respect.
So we have an individual who seems kind of confused and frustrated that you don't identify as being anti-religious or anti-theist, and mentions that the fundamental ideas of the religion support racism. So how is it possible for you to not be against a religion that threatens hell to anyone who thinks freely?
Well, it's my choice. We'll start there. I can be anti-harm and not be anti-religion if I choose, and that's what I choose. And again, these religious expressions, it varies from church to church, community to community. Even if it's the same book, we have races quoting scriptures out of the Bible that support the evil that they do in this world, right? But again, I grew up with a family. Our focus were on different scriptures. Our focus was on help. Our focus was on love, right? I can look at the Bible like it's a book, a regular book, not a heaven and hell determining guide for me. I can read it next to any other book, and there are things that are going to be beautiful in there, and there are things that are going to be absolutely harmful, absolutely disgusting. And still, in my choice, in my autonomy, I choose to be anti-harm, not anti-religious. It's not for me, right? It's not what I choose for me. It's not what I teach my daughter. But I understand that we share a planet with people. We share a country with people that are believers. And I choose to figure out a way to do life and figure out where our values match and can we focus on that. And if there is harm, we'll call it out. But for me personally, I don't think I have to have a label to make someone else feel better about it. It's up to them. Everyone gets to choose that for themselves, right? Whether you're in religion or outside of it, choose it for yourself.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. I think that that we also can acknowledge that there are progressive and non-theistic religions out there. You know, the American Humanist Association works very closely with Unitarian Universalists, ethical culturists, humanistic Jews, humanistic Buddhists. We kind of would like to move away from the assumption that religion is always the fundamentalist, harmful, God-focused, Bible-obsessed view, and especially understanding that the Bible and other sacred texts are not a black and white text. They have delicacies and translations and inaccuracies. But as you said several times, which we'd love to hear, the focus on the worth and dignity of the individual, the empathetic connection with people. So I know we have some people in the chat who are very frustrated that we are not tougher on religious people, but we certainly are tough when it comes to keeping religion out of government so that it does not have that controlling force over everybody. So someone brought up, what exactly is anti-harm? Aren't we all anti-harm? Religious authoritarians don't think they're causing harm after all.
I don't think we all are anti-harm. That's being played out in front of us in our country. Some people really do believe harm is the route. So no, we're not all anti-harm. What does it mean to me? Again, when we say that certain people don't have the right or the access or the freedom, the autonomy over your body, over your thoughts, over your choices, and at any time they can infringe upon another person's choice, we're moving into harm, right? Don't think for yourself, harmful. Right? You got to fit in this box the way we say you should do it. It's not even reality. Harmful. We're creating distrust, first and foremost, in ourselves and amongst each other. There's a big difference. These are the words that I choose to use. This is where I've landed. And this is, I think it's each individual's choice. But absolutely not. I don't think everyone is anti-harm. We're seeing it.
One person in the chat asked about a non-religious 12-step program, and I wanted to mention for folks, there is the Smart Recovery, and I will try to find that link to share quickly. Smart Recovery is a secular addiction recovery program that is available both in person and online across the country. And yes, to the people looking to contact Suandria afterwards, I will share her link again. It is mychoicemypower.com, and that's the best way to contact her directly. I know there were some questions about if you're accepting new clients, if you take insurance, so we can let that be an offline follow-up. Trying to catch up with lots of chats going on and double check Facebook. Here we go. What are your thoughts on mindfulness meditation as a therapist?
I practice it. It's something I share with my clients if it's appropriate, right? Anything that feels like it brings your body, your nervous system to calm, and you can re-engage in a way that you are present and able to speak up and make choices for yourself. If it's, again, if it's something that brings you closer to your truth, not harmful to others, not harmful for yourself, but speaks to your freedom and your autonomy, it's an option. Just depends. But I use it for myself too.
Oh, and there was also a question I missed earlier, asking for your recommendations on books that people can learn more from.
Oh, wow. There's not a lot of books around religious trauma. The term in itself is relatively new. I would visit the Religious Trauma Institute. They have really great resources there, but there are tons of books around trauma in general. Peter, I'll throw some authors out, Van der Kolk, Levine, Mannequin, and I can send, if we're gonna do a follow-up, Emily, mm-hmm. I'm happy to provide some resources there.
There's some inquiry about your experience with clients, like if you've noticed a difference between African-American clients leaving the church than other races, or particularly a difference between them and white Protestants or Catholics.
Themes are usually similar, but in numbers, you know, I'll say my practice leans more towards the white community. I get a lot of followers, a lot of DMs, a lot of kind of peeking over the fence from Black people. It's so deeply intertwined with slavery, racism, and trying to find safety in this country, that the thought of leaving that safety net, even with all the harm that is there, and I'm aware of that, and many of them are aware of that. It's where do we go? I mentioned earlier, where do you go where you can get together with a group of people that make you feel safe, quote unquote, 3-4 times a week, to what? There's no alternative to feel that kind of community and love. So there's a difference. There's a big difference. There's an organization called Black Nonbelievers, and they do a lot of work to provide resources. I partner with them on doing some religious trauma groups. Everyone's welcome, but it is called Black Nonbelievers. But they would be a great resource for people of color.
As you mentioned, the importance of community with religious organizations. We certainly have lots of local humanist groups and work with the local Black non-believers, American atheist, Go Humanity groups. So do you have any recommendations on how our secular communities can support individuals who are still processing and dealing with their religious trauma?
Yeah, I think back to what we were talking about earlier, Emily, around dignity, compassion, empathy. What I've experienced myself, and sometimes some of my clients have come back to me and shared that when you have been religious and you're leaving, you're questioning, you come into some humanist groups, some atheist groups, and it's like, you're stupid. What's wrong with you? Why don't you wake up? Why don't you see this? It's so clear to me. But again, when we're talking about trauma, when we're talking about historical trauma, religious trauma, the it's a complex marriage of things. And it's very hard to walk away. So I think groups that, what groups can do to help ease some of that is be understanding, be compassionate, meet people where they are. Understand that there is a tremendous grieving happening. Tremendous grieving happening. It's terrifying. And honestly, until you really walked it, it's hard to even convey the depth of it. But just some compassion.
Right. And as you say, you know, we're all growing and learning. So we may be different phases of figuring out our journey, and certainly based on who else is around us influencing that. So I think it is essential for our groups to recognize that we all have different stories and should make a space where people are able to share those stories and not kind of make assumptions about us all having the same experience. I know that as in the local DC group, we've had various people break away from fundamentalist religions. And even though they are different religions, they have some similarities in their stories and are able to kind of to share, like, you know, how did you socialize away from the church? That, you know, how did you find people? How did you get out of this kind of disruptive mentality?
Yeah, it's, you know, I spoke earlier about the narratives, and that's where I start with my clients, but just talking through it and finding the connections with each other is extremely helpful. It's extremely healing. Whenever you're trying to heal from trauma that is connected to relationship, it takes healthy relationships to help you find healing and safety and a calmer nervous system as you engage with people. Right. So as people come over to humanist groups, non-believer groups, holding that space to just be loving and safe and to listen or get them to someone that is willing is extremely helpful, because that's part of the healing, to engage again with people, but in a safe space.
So thank you all for your questions and comments, and we'll certainly share them to see if Suandria would like to follow up with us on in another way. But I'm going to give you a chance to go ahead and give us some final thoughts, calls to action before we wrap up the program.
What I jotted down as a call to action is exactly what we talked about right at the end, Emily, is how can we as non-believers, humanists, be more welcome and opening to people that are questioning or have left. And again, it's to look for ways that we connect, honor the stories, encourage the growth, and help people find opportunities to create community, to create chosen families. Because again, a lot of us have lost family, lost friends, and we're starting over. We're full grown adults most of the time, most of my clients. And it feels like an arrested development almost, like I'm starting over on so many levels. So to just be, again, loving, empathetic, a plate at the dinner table, you know, just an invitation to family and to love and to friendship. That would be the call to action.
And also, since we've got you here, and a message went out today about your upcoming further reflection sessions with us, would you like to share a little bit about what people can expect in that July 7th and July 14th program?
Sure. Chris and I chatted a little bit about some ideas around that, and what we're going to do is, in essence, kind of do a religious trauma group. So kind of walk through kind of a shortened, condensed version of what I do in therapy and coaching groups around religious trauma.
Awesome. I will make sure to share that link in the chat as well as on Facebook, but hopefully folks have seen the post on our social media as well as the email that went out to our contacts. So thank you again for sharing with us and teaching us. And I want to thank our audience again for joining us tonight. The recording of this will be available on the AHA Center for Education website, as well as the AHA YouTube channel. We invite you to join more programs online from our Critical Mind series, as well as our upcoming annual conference. And you can always go to AmericanHumanist.org to become a member, donate, learn more about humanism and the work that we're doing. So hope everyone has a great end to your day.